TV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, good afternoon and welcome. I'm Professor Silvera, and we'll be going over Political Science 101, American Institutions, for the next 13 weeks. Just keep in mind that I do have the syllabus posted, so make sure you stay on top of the assignments that are available. I currently have the survey and also as well the death penalty discussion board, so make sure that is completed. And also, I want to keep in mind that this is live. We are currently streaming live in Carson, California. So if you want to get involved during the session, you can call 1-800-339-1193, or you can text, since I know a lot of days today people like to text and send emails. You can send an email to dhtv.csudh.edu. Just some information about my background. What it consists of. I've been teaching as an adjunct faculty for the past 6 years here at Dominguez Hills. I teach international politics and I also teach American politics as well. Previously, what I've worked in the past, I've actually worked as a lobbyist in Sacramento. So I did that for some time. And then I also worked for the European Union Center of California out in Scripps College. And then from there, I also did some work at the local level, at the local county level as well, working in various departments within LA County. So I have a pretty good round of also direct government experience working at the local level and also at the state level as well, and also learning more about the international level. I was also very fortunate to attend Oxford University. I took a course on globalization and trade, which I was very fortunate to do, and I also spent some time in DC. So that's my background, and I'd like to hear more about your background as well, which is why I have the student survey available up on Blackboard. Okay? So the first question I have is, who cares about politics, or why should we care about politics? So the first, I actually have a video that I'd like to show to help you start thinking about this, because this is actually very important and fundamental to this course. So why don't we go ahead and go into the video. It's called American Blackout. It's by a poet, to really think about why we should care about politics. So if we can go into that video, that'd be great. And then we can go into having a discussion about our political relationship.
There's nothing more romantic than fantasy, and we can make the war on terror distracting like videos and TV shows with scantily clad women, cover them with oil, rub it in like lotion, put F-16s in the skies and battleships in the ocean. The voters won't notice, tell them you're either with us or you're against us, and in the same breath over-vaccinate our soldiers. They'll want to believe these lies are the truth, to the point that even Cynthia McKinney with proof won't be able to convince them that there's a connection between the war on terror and the Carlyle Group. They'll need to believe these lies are true. I said over-vaccinate our soldiers and coat their ammunition with radioactive DU. Fear is the final frontier of the defenseless. If it's logical, tell them it's senseless. You're either with us or you're against us. It's all about confusion. Name it the Patriot Act if it acts against the Constitution. One man, one vote is a joke. You should be more concerned about your family being broke. Poof. Mirrors. Smoke. Now watch me raise spending and lower taxes. The answer to any question that the 911 commission might ask is, we believe that stem cell research is immoral. North Korea has WMDs. Translation, time for Operation Iraqi Freedom. Sacrifice American lives on Baghdad soil. Earn more from our investments in defense and increase our supply of oil. The question is, how come we haven't done anything about the genocide in Darfur? The answer is, we believe in protecting the sanctity of marriage. Just give them a slogan. talking. Let's roll. We're gonna smoke them out of their holes. Watch the hands. Watch the hands. And this hand, Osama bin Laden. And this hand, the World Trade Center explodes now. I know you want me to get them for you, but the $200 billion question is, how much is it worth to you for me to allow my cronies' investments in defense to work for you? Don't worry about what we knew prior to the fact about the attacks. That's a distraction. Carol Ann, look away from the oil fields. The important thing to remember is that voting for my opponent will get you killed. There's a connection between his election and your family's demise. That's why African-American voters have to be disenfranchised. Neo-democracy means the electronic voting machine companies get to help us decide. That way you can win the election and still lose. That's the new world order. Global economy, no borders, no sovereignty, widow's cries, corporate plutocracy. True lies.
So what are your thoughts on that? What matters in politics? What's really important about this? So I want you to think about, does democracy matter in times of crisis? And also, I want you to also consider is, how does democracy fit in with your life today? Just two questions to think about. If you can call in, I would like to hear your response, is basically, how does democracy fit in with your life today? And does democracy matter in times of crisis? So you can answer those two questions, that'd be great. Or you can email as well. I also have the email right there, which is askdhtv@gmail.com, and hear your responses to that. Now, I want you to consider your political relationship. I have actually a list of some questions, and what I would like for you to do is see if you answer yes to any of these questions. The first one is, your political relationship is, for instance, have you voted in a presidential election? So did you recently vote in this last election? Second is, have you watched The Daily Show on Comedy Central? I know a lot of people do, and a lot of people do get their politics from there. The third question is, do you consider yourself a member of the AAA for towing services? Maybe it's you, or maybe it's a family member that you could think of. What about driving 10 miles over the speed limit? Is that something you do or that you would honestly admit? And the next one is five, is have you made a $10 contribution or any amount to any candidate for any type of activity? Or have you made a contribution to your local mayor? I know right now there's a lot of city elections going on right now. For instance, in my neighborhood, my mayor is running again for her seat. So I know all over city politics is also very important. And we'll talk more about that as we go through the semester. I have additional questions besides these ones. So what I'd like for you to do is take some time and basically, did you answer yes to any of these questions? And tally those up, because we actually have more questions, because this really helps understand your political relationship with government. Okay, so we got some more questions. Let's go to the next ones. The next question I have is attending a private college or university. Is that something that you plan on doing or that you currently do right now? How about camping out at Yosemite? That'd be nice, right? What about buying a Diet Coke? Or maybe perhaps buying a lotto ticket? And lastly, flushing the toilet. So, if you answered at least 8 to 10 questions correctly, you actually have a very good understanding of what's going on in government today. And if you answered at least 5 to 7 questions correctly, you have some knowledge of somewhat of what's going on. And if you answered less than 5, you actually are in for a surprise, because each of those items are related to government. Yes, all of them are related. So, the question here is, should you care about politics? And I hope the answer is yes, because in our daily lives, we encounter government a lot. You may not directly notice it, but you do. So once you get on the highway, you're abiding by the speed limit, correct? If you go to the DMV and you want to get a license or an ID, that's a state agency. So there's so many factors involved in this. So should you care about politics? The answer should be yes, because definitely there's a lot of things to think about. So I wonder if you voted this past election. Be interested in knowing who you voted for. But there are also some people that are unable to vote or partake in this political process. And these individuals are also called disenfranchised voters. Now, who would be some disenfranchised voters? When you come to think about it, some disenfranchised voters would be, for instance, convicted felons who are no longer eligible to vote, and also undocumented immigrants. These individuals would be considered to be disenfranchised voters. Okay, so what are some myths about government? Do you think the government is large? Do you think there's a lot of red tape? Or, you know, what are some thoughts about the myths of government? Have any songs or movies impacted the way you think of how government runs? Also, too, I want to point out that our government, the U.S. government, is considered to be a federal republic. We are considered ourselves as a republic. And also, too, to a certain extent, we can also consider it to be a representative bureaucracy because we do elect people to represent us. It's not a direct democracy, how it used to be way back in the days. If we were to try to do a direct democracy today, it'd be very difficult because everybody would have to have a say and would take forever. So, which is why we have a representative democracy. So we elect someone to represent us. It could be on the school board, it could be at the city level, it could be at the state level, it could be at the federal level, the congressional or senate level. So those are some things to think about of how this relationship works and how all this stuff is really incorporated with. So going into government, this is basically the foundation, right, to really think about this. We have what is government, what is politics, and what is policy. And I actually have a question from Jimmy, which I will go over. And thanks, Jimmy. I'm going to take a break for a moment to take a look at this. Okay, the way disenfranchised voters define are those who are denied the legal right to vote by intentional or unintentional means. Okay, so some groups are also excluded more than others, right? As I mentioned, convicted felons and immigrants. But the disenfranchised voter here would be, I wouldn't consider it to be people who are under 18. It's just the way the law is, right? So you have to be at least 18 years old to vote. So according to our government, that's the way it should be. So I wouldn't necessarily consider it to be disenfranchised. In my opinion, but if you consider it to be disenfranchised, that's really to you. But just some things to think about. Okay, great. Okay, let's move forward. Okay, so I have government, politics, and policy, and I really appreciate you sending your question, by the way. Okay, so let's move forward. I have what is called the 360-degree view of American institutions. So we have government, we have politics, and we have policy. So how does all this stuff come together? Okay, so what's the goal of government? The goal of government is basically to maintain order through the rule of law. That's basically the role of government. Our government, the United States, is considered to be one of the most populous nations, you know, also the most powerful and also the most dominant if we look at our nation compared to others. So it's very important to have a very strong government for this to happen, because if not, if we had a very weak government, other groups would tend to rise up and tend to try to take control. Okay, so that's the goal of government. The next thing, a part of that too, is politics. Now, what is politics? Okay, so politics is basically activities associated with the governance of an area. That's what politics does. And that's what politicians do, is basically help represent us and also to help achieve what is called policy. Now, there's various different types of policy. There's lots of them. For example, these are very broad. These that I'm going to go over in just a moment. But for instance, I have education. Education would be an example of policy. And when I think of education, I can think of the recent DREAM Act that was just recently enacted. Another area of policy would be healthcare. Now, as I said, that's very broad, right? Healthcare could be a bunch of things. But one of the things about healthcare that I can think about is Medicare for the elderly, and also Medi-Cal for those who aren't able to afford health insurance. And we also have some recent legislation. Some refer to it as Obamacare or the Affordable Health Care Plan. But we do have some legislation that can help regulate and correct this. Okay. Another area of public policy would be housing. For individuals that receive low-income housing, a program that is catered to that is also known as Section 8, and that would fall under housing. I also have transportation. Transportation is also, like I said, very broad. Another area is public safety. And when I think about public policy and public safety, is definitely the recent gun legislation that was just proposed by Obama. And we'll actually look at this, some clips about that in a few moments during this lecture. And lastly, foreign policy. Foreign policy is another type of policy. And foreign policy is just like the name. It's not here domestically, but it has to do with foreign affairs with other foreign countries. So a recent foreign policy that we do have are the sanctions that we impose on Syria because of their oil trade. And as you know, Syria is actually going through a civil war right now. So we're trying to make them not fight. So one of the ways we're doing that is by putting a sanction on them so they can't trade, so they can't make money, in other words. Another country that we have sanctions on is Iran. Now, our relationship with Iran is not as great as it could be, but one of the things that we do, America looks at when it comes to Iran, is that Iran has been building up their nuclear enrichment to build nuclear weapons. Now, in order for Iran to stop doing that, we impose a sanction on them, also on their oil as well. So that's a type of foreign policy. There are different types, but those are some examples of public policy when it comes down to it, because politicians enact public policy. Okay, and also government helps instill that, the rule of law. Okay, so that's the main goal of government's politics and policy. So where should the governmental authority be vested at? At what level? What level do you think government authority should be vested at? Should it be at the national level? Should it be at the federal level, right? Or should it be at the state level? Okay. Or should it be at the local city level? What do you think? What do you think government, most of the government authority should be at? I would like to hear your comments in regards to that. So if you can call in, or if you can send an email or a text, I would appreciate that. So where should government authority be vested, in your opinion? Should it be at the federal level? Should it be the state level? Or should it be the local level? And the reason being is because we're going to go into this next segment here. Now, this next segment here is about the recent shootings that we've been having here in our country. Now, as you are all aware of, the recent killings that happened at Sandy Hook Elementary School, and prior to that, there were also the killings in Aurora, Colorado, of what happened at the movie theater. And there's so many out there. What's going on in Chicago, for instance, there's a lot of killings there among the youth, and it's just so much. There's just so much killings that are going. Innocent victims are dying because of individuals that have access to guns. Now, we do have some proposals on the table by our president to help lessen the amount of weapons, lessen the amount of ammunition that's on the streets. But you know, what else can we do about this besides having these policies that lessens the amount of these types of weapons or who gets these types of weapons? But what else can we do? Are we forgetting something? Are we forgetting something when we're making these types of policies? And I just want to go over Obama's gun control proposal, some of the outlines that I have here. And then I'd actually like to take a look at some videos in regards to this proposed gun legislation. So for instance, what I have here is actually from the New York Times. And what Obama's proposing in regards to gun control is actually requiring criminal backgrounds for all gun sales, also including the private sellers, because private sellers are actually exempt from getting a criminal background check. So this would require them to also get a background check. Another thing too is also increasing criminal penalties for what is called straw purchasers. Now, straw purchasers are people who would buy the gun, and after they purchase the gun, they would give it to somebody else. So they are proposing increased penalties for individuals who do that. Also to limiting ammunition magazines to about 10 rounds is another thing that's on the table as well. And also to train more police officers, as well as first responders and school officials, on how to respond to armed attacks. So more training is also included in the proposal. Also to help keep 15,000 more police officers on the street as well. So what else do you think should be included in this new gun control proposal that's being presented? What else do you think should be included? I would appreciate your comments, or if you can call in, what else do you think should be also included when it comes to that? So if we can go into the video on Obama's gun control proposal legislation, and then from there we also have another video on Chicago, what's going on in Chicago. Okay, so I guess that didn't work. So why don't we move forward and then we could try coming back to that in just another time. Okay.
So right now, Democrats and Republicans in the Senate are working on a bill that would ban anyone from selling a gun to somebody legally prohibited from owning one. That's common sense. There's no reason why we can't get that done. That is not a liberal idea or a conservative idea. It's not a Democratic or Republican idea. That is a smart idea. We want to keep those guns out of the hands of folks who shouldn't have them. Senators from both parties have also come together and proposed a bill that would crack down on people who buy guns only to turn them around and sell them to criminals. It's a bill that would keep more guns off the street and out of the hands of people with the intent of doing harm. And by the way, in addition to reducing violence on the streets, it would also make life a lot easier and a lot safer for the people standing behind me here today. We shouldn't stop there. We should restore the ban on military-style assault weapons and a 10-round limit for magazines. And that deserves a vote in Congress, because weapons of war have no place on our streets or in our schools or threatening our law enforcement officers. Our law enforcement officers should never be outgunned.
Okay, so what are your thoughts about that, about gun control? I'd appreciate your phone call. You can call the number 1-800-339-1193, or you can text or you can email. But what else do you think needs to be included in this type of gun proposal legislation? Because it's very important. I mean, some of you may, I know there are some people out there who are part of different interest groups. Maybe some of you do like to go to the range and go shooting. So, I mean, as you know, one of the interest groups that's out there right now is the NRA, the National Rifle Association, that's actually advocating against the legislation, because obviously they want their rights, the gun owners, to have more rights. So it's kind of taking away their rights by having this gun legislation. But depending on where you stand on this issue, I'd like to hear what you have to say. Is this something, do you think it's taking away the rights of gun owners, or is this good, or is it not good enough? Do you think there's something else that has to be included in this? I would really appreciate your thoughts about this. Now, I do have a comment from one of the viewers, from Gabriella. And going back to the question about where should governmental authority be vested at? Should it be at the federal level? Should it be at the state level, or should it be at the local level? And Gabriella mentions that, she mentions that government should be at mostly the local level, if possible. For example, military should be with the federal, and also the cities should be the ones to have the laws in regards to having strict gun legislation, especially when it comes to violent cities. One of the violent cities that we'll be taking a look at in just a moment is Chicago, because as you know, Chicago has been receiving a lot of gun violence. One of the people who was at Obama's inauguration, a 15-year-old, you may have seen in the news, has passed recently because of this gun violence. There is issue with gangs, there's an issue with drugs. There's definitely other factors to look at when it comes to gun violence, but what else can we do to stop this? Now, also, too, just some things to consider about this gun legislation. So I would actually like to go into the video in regards to Chicago, of what's been going on there. As of recently, somebody, besides the individual who passed the other week, there have been other killings. One individual was killed riding the bus, which is very unfortunate. So if we can go into the next video, and we could take a look at that and what his mother is doing in regards to what's been going on in Chicago.
It was May 10th, 2007. A surveillance tape captured a teenager with a gun boarding a Chicago bus and shooting.
A crowded bus full of teenagers and people coming home from work. He shoots five kids that day, five teenagers, and my son died as a result of that.
Annette Nance Holt's only child, Blair, was 16. More than 2,300 people have been killed by guns in Chicago in the years that followed.
Do you think the public is indifferent?
I think a lot of people are indifferent because they figure it didn't happen to them, or they figure most of our kids in our community are gangbangers or drug dealers or don't go to school, they're uneducated, they don't have fathers or they don't have mothers. I think a lot of people look at us like that, and that's not true. When my son was murdered, I got a letter in the mail. It wasn't a week later. Somebody found out where I live. They mailed me a letter and said, had somebody on the bus been armed, if everybody on the bus had a gun and been armed, my son would be alive. No, I think a lot of people on the bus would be dead today.
Following her son's death, Nance Holt co-founded Purpose Over Pain, an organization that advocates for gun control. Last week, she met with Vice President Biden's task force on gun violence.
What is the something that we have to do?
First, the mothers and fathers who've lost their children to violence, raise up and say something now. It's hard. I know it's hard to stand up, but we all need to stand up and give our voices. We need to write politicians. We need to call them. We need to march. We need to rally.
What would you say to the National Rifle Association?
I would say they need to come up with some common sense plan to how we can combat gun violence. It's not getting more guns. That's not a common sense plan to a mother like me or to other families in the city of Chicago who've lost their children to violence.
And for those who believe it could never happen to their family, Annette Nance Holt says she once felt that way too.
Okay, so gun violence is real. It could happen to anybody, as you saw in this video segment in Chicago. Now, his mother, as you saw, did develop her own organization called Purpose Over Pain, which is also helping to lobby politicians to enact gun control legislation. Now, I actually have a caller that I'd like to go. I'd like to take this caller. Okay. Hi. Alana?
Hi.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good.
Good. What's your question, Alana?
I just had a question on for the gun control.
Okay.
Because, like, my concern would just be that if people are, like, going to break the law and they're going to go out and shoot somebody, wouldn't they break the law of gun control? So wouldn't we just be taking away, like, guns and stuff from people who aren't breaking the law, and then the people who are already going to break the law aren't going to care about breaking, like, a gun control law?
Okay, that's a really good question. You pointed out something really interesting right there, okay? So we're talking about this gun control, right, about limiting ammunition, about putting additional penalties. But yeah, I actually haven't seen anything that actually goes to the person that actually shot off, you know, the rifle, let's just say, for example. So I'd actually have to go back and look at the proposal. What I have here actually doesn't really address that, so I don't have the information that I have right here. But maybe out there, there's probably additional information. Maybe there's a stricter penalty for an individual mm-hmm. that were to shoot off a gun. So I'd have to take a look more into depth about that. So I think that's a really good point, a really good point. Did you have any additional questions, Alana?
No.
Okay. Well, thank you for calling. Okay. That was Alana from El Dorado. Thank you for calling so much. If you'd like to call in with your questions or with your comments, you can call 1-800-339-1193, or you can text or you can email any of your questions, because I get them right here and I can also look at that as well. And I really appreciate the interaction that I have. Okay. Now I have some comments from students that have been sending me some messages. One of them is from Michaela. And Michaela, in regards to gun legislation, she feels that people, when they buy guns, that they have to take a test before they actually get sold to them. So they should be tested on before they make the purchase. So that's one proposal. Another one is by Alex, I believe if I'm saying that correctly. Only people with permits should own firearms and should only be allowed to carry them or buy and sell them. So individuals that have permits should be the only ones eligible to hold and carry them. Okay, good. Now I have another question here, another comment, and this is by Jonathan. His comment here is, what is the difference between a man with 100 bullets and one gun or a man with 10 bullets with 10 guns? Very good question. Something to consider. I would think the penalties the same, but just something to consider. Thank you. Maddie, another comment from Maddie in regards to gun legislation is, I think there should be gun control, but not so much that it violates the Second Amendment by completely taking away our rights to own guns. Now, very good, Maddie. I'm glad you brought that up, because that is in our Constitution, in our Bill of Rights. The Second Amendment is that we as individuals have the right to bear arms. And we're actually going to talk more about the Bill of Rights next week, next Tuesday. But very good. You brought this really important notion up. So we should have guns, but not so much that it's going to completely eliminate them, because that is our right. Now, speaking about our country compared to other countries don't have that in their Bill of Rights or in that Constitution. So when we look at other countries do not have the right to bear arms. And if they get caught with a gun, they get thrown in jail for a very long time. So just something to think about, in particular when we look at this about gun legislation, comparing our country to others. Now, I have another comment by Gabby, which she mentions that guns are not the only problem. Okay, good, very good. We also need to make sure that people who own them are mentally stable. Some people, they do blame video games or videos, etc. But it's actually up to the individual who's responsible for our own actions. Good. So something also to consider about the mental health of a person. Are they capable of, you know, having a gun, of operating it, and not using it, you know, the wrong way? Just something to consider. I also had another comment by Jonathan, and thank you very much for bringing that to my attention. But this is great. I really appreciate this interaction, because I have a lot of comments, so I want to go over a few more. This is by Michaela, which she mentions is that not everything about guns is bad. Many people have been saved by bad people because of guns. Okay. Something to consider. Okay. So I really appreciate your comments on this, and that's it. If anybody else would like to comment on government or politics or its policy, definitely send in your email or text, and I'll be make sure to get it, and I can read it here on this broadcast. Or you can call in. You can call in, so I would appreciate that. So talking about gun legislation, what's Chicago doing right now? And as I mentioned, Chicago is a city that's receiving a lot of murder rates right now compared to other countries across the nation. So I do have a segment on Chicago about what Chicago's doing in regards to gun control. So if we can go into the video in regards to gun control in Chicago. Okay, just take a few more minutes. Okay, so what is Chicago doing right now in regards to gun control? And as you saw in the earlier video clip, you know, people are dying, innocent people are dying because of this is happening. So what can we do? How can we make Chicago safe? And not just Chicago, all of America. How can we make our country safe again? What can we do? Do we need to put more police officers on the street? Do we need to educate our people about, you know, about crime, you know, about how to stay away from crime, how to stay away from criminals? You know, what do we do? So another question I want to pose out there for those of you who are watching right now, because we are live, is do you think the economy has something to do with our increase in crime rates? Do you think the economy and crime are related, especially what's been going on as of recently? Do you think that's one of the issues? Or what else do you think can be influencing why crime is continually to escalate? So what are your thoughts? You can call, you can send a text or email, but what do you think is causing these crime rates to go up? These innocent people are dying. Why do you think that's starting to happen a lot more? Especially when we watch the news, we hear a lot more about that. So why do you think this is happening? You know, is it, you know, because of the economy, or is it because of the mental health of the person? What are the other factors that influence this? So it's something to consider. I'd really appreciate your responses to this. So how about we take a look about what's going on in Chicago and how they're dealing with this problem.
And so today, as always, we're going to make sure that we're deployed to our conflict zones.
Commander Lynette Helm gives the afternoon shift their orders before they head out to their beats in Chicago's 3rd Police District on the city's south side. Officers once in specialized units and desk jobs are now being moved to the street. It's part of a new strategy to combat violence that Deputy Chief Eddie Johnson says is working.
These guys are actually assigned to the districts. They're assigned to those beats, so they get to know the community people. They get to know the gang members. You know, there's a difference in, you know, the kid, the 16-year-old going to play basketball and the 16-year-old going out to gangbang.
Some Chicago aldermen think the old strategy of deploying specialized rapid response units to saturate an area once violence broke out was more effective.
We saw a big difference when that would happen. It was like, you know, in war where you throw it all down and it scatters and everybody gets scared. It's a little good scare tactic. And so, yeah, from the community standpoint, it worked.
But that saturation strategy brought only short-term results, says Chicago Police Superintendent Gary McCarthy.
First of all, saturating it is like putting a gunshot, is like putting a Band-Aid on a gunshot wound. We're not repairing anything by doing that.
Since getting more officers back on the streets, most crime statistics are down. But the murder rate has soared. And Mayor Rahm Emanuel has staked his reputation on bringing the rate down. In the 3rd Police District, murder is up 91% over last year.
What do you hear?
Multiple gunshots. I mean, like the war zone. You know, not just a couple of shots. And they in separate places. It's not just like one block is, you know, 4 different places where they shooting at.
The 3rd District encompasses gritty street corners, vacant land, and boarded up buildings. But it also has quiet tree-lined streets. Michelle Obama's childhood home is in the 3rd District. Police say 75% to 80% of the murders and shootings here are gang-related.
So one of the things that we did early on was conducted a gang audit in all 23 districts in the city. That information is then given to the district commanders along with the field officers and the frontline supervisors. One of the things that we focus on is it's difficult to stop the first shooting sometimes, but we focus on the subsequent shootings, you know, because sometimes one shooting will result in 3, 4, 5, 6 additional shootings.
When officers Barbara Jenkins and Amin Mustafa are on patrol, they have all the information from the gang audit at their fingertips. Whenever they stop someone, the officers immediately go to their computer.
The gang audit has been extremely important, an important tool for the field officers. Before, like when I came on the job, you know, we didn't have portable data terminals to you know, run a name check or anything. But now an officer can, you know, run a name, put a name in their computer, in their portable data terminal, and come up with a gang member's name and come up with, you know, associates or things of that nature that can help them in their crime fighting.
The homicide rate has slowed down some in the month of June. But on June 24th, a 13-year-old was gunned down right here on this block. His was the 21st death in the district since January 1st. The 13-year-old's murder is under investigation with no suspects in custody. After that killing and a big spike in the number of shootings, Commander Helms again adjusted the crime-fighting strategy.
We identified violent zones in our district where we put officers, you know, in that area to, you know, to do these missions. But we also, like I said, we did more contact with the community. We have the officers doing foot patrol. We did a whole lot of holistic approaches. We've got our churches involved. We've asked them to open their doors. So those are some of the things that we did a little bit differently.
There are over 175 churches and mosques in the 3rd Police District, ranging from huge institutions to small storefronts. And many have responded to the crisis of violence. Charles Matthews takes his church's message to the streets.
Nothing won't happen to you like what happened over here with this little boy that got killed over here.
Matthew tells the kids about several summer programs offered by the church and urges them to give the programs a try. He became a parent volunteer for the church after getting fed up with the neighborhood violence.
I got involved because I'm hurting for the community.
The Parkway Gardens Christian Church kept its Safe Haven program running in the summer, even though it lost its funding from the Chicago Public Schools. It's a second job for director Jennifer Maddox. A Chicago police officer, Maddox is assigned to the 3rd District.
It's frustrating to see the kids out here, you know, in the violence, and they're, you know, getting shot at, running from, you know, violence and things like that. That's why it's so important to have some activities for them to do so that they won't be hanging on the corners.
Pastor Edward Morris keeps a watchful eye on a group of older boys as they play a hot game of basketball.
Every kid that we can get off the street, every teenager particularly, or African American male, so that we can have in a place like this during the times of the shootings, where they know they've got a safe place to come. We feel that we've put in somewhat of a dent in it. While it may appear to be a Band-Aid, if there's just one life that's saved, there's just one kid that changes his mind on how he wants to exist in this world, we believe we're making a difference.
A safe haven is important for kids like 16-year-old Antoine Varner, a program counselor.
It's unsafe. Like, I'm actually afraid to walk out my front door.
Have gangs ever tried to recruit you?
No.
Why not? What have you done to say no?
Because the guys that I went to school with know I'm not that type of person, so they never try.
The district also includes the Gary Comer Youth Center and Charter School, whose summer programs include a gardening class. The center serves more than 1,200 kids each year with a budget of $16 million. With all the resources Comer has poured into the area, the rise in violence is frustrating, says Executive Director Greg Mooney.
Of course it's frustrating. I mean, I don't know anybody who isn't frustrated by the violence in Chicago. But really, without, you know, a place like the Gary Comer Youth Center and Gary Comer College Prep, our young people are more vulnerable to the violence that surrounds them.
And despite the opportunities, Comer College Prep students like Dominique Jones are still strongly impacted by the neighborhood violence.
I'm afraid of dying at a young age, not being able to fulfill my dreams.
Those fighting against the violence in the 3rd District all agree on one point. The effort must involve the entire community.
The police can't do this alone. There's no way we're going to arrest our way out of this situation. So we absolutely need community input to try to make an impact.
The community, says Reverend Morris, is ready to respond.
These are our neighborhoods. It doesn't belong to the gangbangers and the drug dealers and the drug pushers. It belongs to us. And I believe that with the efforts that so many churches and neighborhood organizations are making, we're going to take it back. We just can't stop.
The 3rd District has just gotten some help in battling the high homicide rate. The city is bringing in 20 members of Operation Ceasefire, a group that works to cool down street violence. Previously, the state of Illinois has funded Ceasefire's work in the city. Chicago police have been reluctant to work with Ceasefire, as many are ex-felons. But with the homicide rate soaring, Mayor Rahm Emanuel says it's time to reach out to any group that can make a difference.
Okay, so what are your thoughts about that video? Any comments that you have? You can email them. You can go to dhtv.csudh.edu, or you can call up. What else do we need to do to get more involved into the community? As you saw, Chicago does have a center, an after-school center, as well, and you also saw the involvement of the community and also the police officers. So what else should we do? Now, I don't know if any of you have visited Chicago, but Chicago is a great city. It's a beautiful city right by the lake. It's wonderful. It's a great city. I highly recommend it. If you want to go visit somewhere, I'd recommend it. But right now, I guess with the crime, I don't know if that'd be a good idea. But anyhow, Chicago is a great city, and it's very unfortunate to hear that they're having this issue with crime. So just some thoughts on what you think about the recent video that we did just watch about Chicago. Now, I would like to depart from gun legislation, and we're actually going to move forward, and we're going to talk about some political principles. Now, some political principles that we have in terms of American institutions, because that's what we're talking about here, is basically this idea of American exceptionalism. And what that basically means is that what we strive for here on a domestic level is freedom and equality. And also, too, another thing that we strive for here in America is we like to influence democracy, not just here in our own country, but also internationally as well. So, for instance, in Afghanistan, the current war that we have right now, or how Iraq is now becoming a democracy is something that we strive for, because what we think when it comes to democracy is that as more countries become democratic, they'll be less likely to go to war, less likely to conflict. So whether you agree with that or not, that is a theory. It's actually called the democratic peace theory, that countries that are more likely to be democratic will be less likely to go to war. Now, before we go into additional political principles, I do have some comments from students and from viewers as well. And I'd actually like to go over this. Our first comment comes from Alana. Now, the question I asked earlier, do you think the economy and crime are related? Do you think because, as you know, our economy is not doing so well, our economy's, you know, going down and crime is going up, do you think there's a relationship that's linked together? Now, Alana feels that the economy does have a big role in what's going on in this increase in crime because many people are becoming depressed and are taking drugs due to financial issues. And this is where the violence is coming from. And very good comment. Definitely, as people are becoming more strapped for cash, you know, it becomes very difficult to pay the bills. It gets very frustrating. People do get stressed out. It's very fortunate how they're going to make ends meet. And when that happens, sometimes people do rely on other illicit types of behaviors, such as drugs or committing crimes. So thank you for your comment. And my next comment I have here is from Alex. And Alex mentions that the worse the economy is, the worse that people are doing, and the more needs that they have, and most will about anything that they need to do to get them for themselves and for their families, even if it's crime. So if an individual can't put food on the table, maybe that person may have to, you know, rob or steal or shoplift or et cetera to kind of provide ends to their family. Thank you. Another comment that I have is from Maddie. Maddie says that I think that the economy is affecting the crime rate because people are becoming more desperate for what they need and might not have the money to provide those needs. Thank you. I have another comment from Gabriella. And this goes back to actually talking about crime and talking about guns. And if we made a law prohibiting guns, it wouldn't stop criminals from breaking the law, accessing guns and committing crimes anyways, right? So that's the comment that Gabriella has in relation to how crime and guns are related to this. Now, Emma suggests that the economy has a lot to do with the rising rates of crime in the U.S. Many people don't have work and are unemployed. And also, too, I just want to comment on that, Emma, is that also, too, a lot of people out there are underemployed, meaning that they have the skills and the education that they acquired, but they don't have the jobs to meet those needs. So going back to Emma's comment, whenever you have people with too much time on their hands, crime rates go up. Okay, and that's from Emma. Thank you. I have another one from Anna. I think economy could definitely contribute to crime. When someone has low income, they may feel they have nothing to lose by committing a crime. They may even benefit by the care given in prison. Huh, interesting. Okay, so maybe an individual doesn't have means to provide them for themselves or a place to eat or food to eat or health care. So maybe an individual going to prison or to a juvenile facility might benefit from that because they're going to get all the care that they need. Okay, all right. Okay, from Victoria. How much of a difference is there between the homicide rates in a low-income community and a higher-income community in Chicago? I don't have those rates on the top of my head right now, but I can see if I could come across that between the crime rates between low and higher-income communities. I doubt the crime rates in higher-income communities are higher than the ones in the lower-income communities, but I would have to double-check that, so I will try to find some information to answer that question. Okay, this is from Carlos. What are the reasons for the rise in violence, and why is violence higher now than in the past years? Now, we're talking about how violence is related to the economy. So maybe it could be from the economy, maybe it could be for other various factors, but this is a question I'm asking you. And a lot of you are saying that it is due to the economy, because our economy is not doing that great. A lot of people do feel that this is in relation to why crime levels are going up. Okay, now, this is from Michaela. Michaela says this, that none of us should feel scared to walk out of our door. It's very sad that so many people do. Now, Michaela, great comment. I just want to share something personal. Actually, in the community where I live, out here in Southeast Los Angeles, I've noticed that crime levels have been going up. I've noticed there have been additional car thefts. There have been robberies, home invasions, you know, et cetera, home robberies, excuse me. But we've had an increase in crime. Now, what basically I did was basically contact my city council members and alert them that this has been occurring. Also, too, there was a sexual assault at my local park. So a lot of stuff has been going on, and not just in certain, you know, just in one city, but it's happening all over the country. Now, when I did that, my city council is trying to take measures to try to, you know, have more police officers on the streets, et cetera. But also, too, comes back to the community as well. One of the things that I personally did was I gathered people from my neighborhood and did like a neighborhood watch, which I'm pretty sure a lot of you are familiar with, to kind of help solve these issues. Because sometimes some people see these crimes occurring, but they look the other way or they don't say nothing. So also too, community involvement, to get the community involved is another thing too. So just something to think about. If you see crime a lot in your city, in your area, you may want to contact your local city officials because they'll be able to help in this area. I have another comment here from Gabriella. I think I saw this one a little bit earlier in regards to people being underemployed, also being on drugs, which makes them want to go into the life of crime or be involved with gangs. So something also to think about how all of this is interconnected, because it is. When it comes down to it, it really is. All of this stuff is interconnected. Something causes something else, okay? There's always a cause and effect, as what people usually say. It's always something that influences something else. So if there's any additional comments, I would appreciate if you can send them in, or if you'd like to talk on the phone and give me a call here at 1-800-339-1193 so I can hear you verbally mention your comments also as questions. Okay, so I have a comment here from Alana. When government gives welfare to people on drugs who are not providing anything good for society, it creates a mindset where people can go down the wrong path and get involved in gangs. I feel that we should not just have welfare where if you are lower class, you get, I guess that's free handouts. But, you know, just depending on where you're at on this issue, I would really like to hear what you have to say about this, about how the economy, how crime, how all of this stuff is related. Because it's happening. Okay, and it's not happening in just one city. I'm just using example Chicago as an example because they have been a city that has been, going through a lot of crime rates as of recent, but also other cities as well. And it does start, like I said, it starts at the level in your local communities is where you're going to see it. It may be some things that you may see that may be petty, but they do escalate into something a lot larger than that. So it's definitely something to watch for in your community. Okay, so how about we go into a break? We're going to take about a 5-minute break, and then we're going to come back and we'll continue the subject of political science of American institutions, and we'll talk about the foundations of political principles, and then from there we're going to talk about ideologies. I want to know what ideologies do you stand? Are you considered to be a liberal? Are you considered to be a conservative? You know, et cetera. So where do you stand on this? So. I would like to hear your comments. We're going to come back. We're going to talk about political principles and also political ideologies. And we'll also go into some clips as well. Okay, so we'll be back in 5 minutes and we'll continue from there.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
Thank you.
My name is Ileana Gutierrez. I'm a communications major here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I have my own radio show at KDHR, our on-campus radio station. The reason I chose Cal State Dominguez Hills is because of its beautiful campus and cultural diversity.
This is my university.
Hey, Mark, nice paper.
Now this is student life. Sweet!
Attention businesses in the South Bay of Los Angeles. The South Bay Resource Network and the South Bay One Stops are here to help you grow.
I found out about the One Stop. A representative came to my store and presented the services that they provide.
We have had, since we've opened, over 4,000 applicants. We only had 125 jobs, and One Stop really helped us find the true gems in, out of all those people.
On the business side, the One Stop provides not only training, but it provides a resource for contacts. Also provides a resource for training in terms of being able to take someone there to actually train them, use the facility. They offer computer classes, a myriad of things that they do.
It was just a great experience. The members of the One Stop were always helpful and understanding.
With services designed to help your business succeed, the South Bay Resource Network is here for you. Call 310-970-7799 or visit our website at southbayresource.net.
The One Stop is your resource for business in the South Bay.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636. 3636.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Okay, we're back. Hope you enjoyed the break. So here we are again. We're talking about American institutions. We are currently broadcasting live and direct from Carson, California, here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. So what I'd like to go into, I want to talk about the foundation of political principles. Now, you can find this in chapter 1 of your textbook. Now, the background of American government, if we really start to think about it, does come from the Greeks, and then after that it comes from the Romans, and then it goes into Protestant. And then we just kind of pick and pull from those type of ideas what we have our government founding today. Now, some of the foundations of political principles, as I mentioned, does come from the Greek initially. And initially, the Greeks believed that there should be one ruler, ruled by the best person eligible to do this. So for instance, a monarchy, having a king, for instance, should be the person to rule in this case. Now, the opposite of a monarchy is also known as a tyranny. which would be the opposite. So if you have that one best ruler, sometimes that one best ruler could turn up to be not that great and can end up being a dictator, you know, violating human rights, civil rights, etc. So that's the difference between the monarchy and tyranny of this picture that you're looking at here, is that you have what we expect to be the good side, and then the opposite side would be the complete, I guess you could see, the negative side in this. The next one is aristocracy. This is actually ruled by a few people, ruled by a few elite. But sometimes if you have an area, a city, or a community that's ruled by a few people or the elite, it can also lead to corruption, just elite rule. Because if it's solely the elite that's governing, they may not consider the other people in the community. And lastly, we have a democracy. A democracy is ruled by the people. And the opposite of a democracy would be a mob rule. So basically like the mafia, in other words, which is a very a negative aspect of this. Or you could think of maybe gangs, you know, etc. So those are the different types of political principles. And initially, all of this stuff started with the Greeks. The Greeks are the ones who came up with this type of notion. Also with Plato and Aristotle, a lot of this does come from philosophy. And then from there, it goes into the Romans. And the Romans actually decided to mix these three areas of a monarchy and aristocracy and also democratic principles and how they govern their society. And then from there, Christianity, which is also referred to in this process in politics, political science back in the day, is known as the Middle Ages, of how Christianity also influenced politics. So the kings were actually given their positions by the Pope. The Pope was the one who had a lot of influence on what was going on. And as time goes on, as you can see, we just kind of pick and pull from some of these ideas, which leads us to what we have from to today. Also to other individuals that had an influence in our government is also John Locke is another individual. He also wrote his book, The Two Treatises of Government, when he came about with this social contract theory. Basically, government is based on the free people, should lead to peace, prosperity, also too when it comes to property, etc. So those are also other things where we kind of pulled from John Locke and also from Hobbes and different individuals. So if we go back in time, we can kind of see how all of this stuff comes together. We kind of just kind of like picked and pulled from other individuals who thought about how we should govern our society. Now, we're actually going to go into political ideologies, which is the next section we're going to go over, and actually have some videos. So what's an ideology? Basically, an ideology is basically a tool to help us think about how government is doing or how it should be doing. Now, there's different types of ideologies. We have what is known as populist, we have conservatist, liberalism, and also a libertarianism. So we have different types of political ideology. Now, I'm going to go over these because I'm actually interested in knowing which ideology you fall under. Now, going to conservatism, also known as conservatives, these are individuals who are leaning a bit more to the right or on the right when it comes to this. And these are individuals who actually favor increased regulation of private lives for moral purposes, but they do oppose government interference. Now, a great example that I could think of somebody who'd be conservative in a certain type of policy would be actually conservatives are actually against abortion. These individuals would be more likely to be pro-life. Okay, that's just an example of a conservative. So if you feel that you are pro-life, and it's not just only that policy issue, there's also different ones who could be the economy and etc. But that's just an example that I put out there, is that these are individuals who favor increased regulation of the private life for moral purposes, but oppose government interference within the economy. So that's just an example. The next one I have is liberalism. Liberalism actually favors increased government intervention, but imposes increased limits on personal freedom. Now, when I think of liberalism, or people who are liberalist, I actually think of individuals who actually would favor marijuana legislation. That's what I think of. As you know, we do have two states that recently passed legislation that makes it legal for individuals to smoke marijuana, especially if it's in their home. You know, it said it has to be private. They can't smoke out in public. But that's what I think of when I think of a liberalist. So they favor increased government intervention, but they oppose limits on personal freedom. So that could be someone's personal freedom is smoking smoking marijuana. Another type of ideology that I have up here is also known as populism. Now, populism actually favors government intervention in both economic and personal matters. Okay. Another one I have here is libertarianism. So this is a belief that government should only do no more than what is necessary in areas of both economic affairs and personal freedom. Now, what they feel is that basically they want very limited government intervention. Okay. So the government should only do just so much, and then that's it. So it's very, I'm trying to look for the appropriate term for this, but basically just very minimal governmental intervention. That's what a libertarian would believe. Uh-huh. So those are the different types of ideologies that I have here. So my question to you here is, which ideology are you and why? Do you consider yourself a conservative? Do you consider yourself a liberalist or a populist? What do you consider yourself to be? So I actually have a comment here so far, and I encourage you to either call in or either text or email your comments. So the first comment I have here is from Alana, and Alana feels that she's in the middle of the two parties because she is conservative when it comes to political issues, but liberal when it comes to social issues. And that's totally fine. You could be in the middle. You could either be not too far right and not too far left, just in the middle. So that's fine. So my question to you is, which ideology are you? Are you conservative? Are you liberal? Et cetera. So how about we look at some videos? I have one where youth voters are speaking out at the University in Washington. And then I also have another clip of how individuals think if they look at certain items, if they are considered to be conservative or they're considered to be liberal. So how about we go into those videos, and if you could please send in your comments, or you could telephone your comments as well as which ideology are you. You can call 1-800-339-1193, or you could text or email your questions at dhtv.csudh.edu. So how about we go in those videos.
Some Washington State University students choose not to vote. However, other students find the meaning behind the process more significant.
I voted in 2004 when I was 18. I just aged myself. And I was overseas in 2008, and my absentee didn't come in time, so I'm looking forward to voting this election.
I have thought about voting. Voting is very important. On a college campus here, a lot of people don't vote. They don't think that their vote matters, but that's not true. Well, I am a Democrat, so I'm most likely going to go vote for Obama, but it's not as if I haven't looked at the Republican options.
ASWSU Director of Finance Jake Mason finds apathy as more of a common trend among his peers.
The apathy is the most frustrating thing to deal with. There are, around 15,000, almost 16,000 undergraduates on campus, and we only get about 2,000, 3,000 voter turnout.
No, I haven't really thought that much about the election. I've got a lot of other stuff going on, like looking for a job and passing all my tests so I can graduate in May, so.
Despite how and if Washington students are voting, an important concern in the upcoming presidential election is why students are voting the way they are.
There are some theories out there about why people vote the way they do or why they identify with a particular party that they do, and some kind of social identity theories say that we're trying to figure out who we are. Once we figure that out, then we start to look at the political parties and say, well, which political party are most feminists in or most environmentalists in? There's influence of peers as well. There's influence of the news media. So kind of all of those factors they call agents of socialization are working to have an impact upon young people's political worldviews.
Some may argue it will be to the candidate's advantage to understand this aspect of the election in the social media age.
Being on college campus, Facebook is the number one social media site.
Professor Rideau has been studying the internet and the impact that it has on campaigns.
We're still trying to figure out the impact of the internet on voting. And in one sense, it's made participation easier. It's easier to organize people locally because of the internet.
However, some political influences run deeper than the internet.
Throughout my whole life, both my parents are Democrats, so I'd be ignorant to believe that that didn't have an effect on me. So definitely my parents, my experiences with people, I grew up in a place where there was a lot of low-income neighborhoods, and a lot of my friends don't have a lot of money. And so that kind of shifted me towards a liberal way of looking at politics, and I think that's what ultimately shaped my political beliefs to this day.
Students have many different influences when developing their political beliefs. But one thing's for certain, youth voters will be very important in this year's upcoming presidential election. With photographer Brady Bonser, I'm reporter Veronica Miracle with the Murrow News Service.
Okay, so are you a conservative or are you a liberalist? So I have some comments here that I like to read, and then from there we can go into the other clip that I have too here. This is from Gabriella. Gabriella considers herself a conservative, and she favors minimal governmental intervention, and also too, she is pro-life. Okay, thank you, Gabriella. I have another comment here from Alex. Is our democracy turning into mob rule? Depending on how you look at it, but I personally don't think so. So just depending on how you look at it, I'd like to hear more about that and why you consider that we are going towards more of a mob rule. So maybe you can send another email in regards to that. I have another comment here from Maddie. Maddie also considers to be a conservative and also pro-life, and also believes that abortion is murder and is also very wrong. Okay, so that's what Maddie believes, and that's where Maddie's ideology is at, is to be a conservative. Thank you. Okay, this is from Jonathan. Now, Jonathan says, is it true that soldiers overseas are not allowed to vote? If so, why not? Now, I'm not sure about soldiers overseas that are not allowed to vote. I actually thought they were, so I'm not sure. I'd have to actually take a look at that, and I can get back to you in regards to if soldiers overseas are not allowed to vote, because I thought they were, so I wasn't aware of that. Okay, this is from Michaela. Okay, Michaela also is a conservative and feels very strongly about pro-life and also thinks abortion is wrong. I have a lot of conservatives that have been sending their comments. I wonder if there's any liberalists out there, any people who consider themselves to be liberalists. So if you are considered to be liberalist, I'd like to hear why you are. You could either call in or you could send your text or email. And in response to your question about soldiers being able to vote overseas, yes, actually soldiers overseas can vote, and you vote absentee with an absentee ballot. So that just answers your question right there. Okay. Anybody else? Where do you stand? What ideology are you? Are you conservative? Are you liberal? You know, what ideology do you pertain to? You can email your response to askdhtv@gmail.com, or you can call up at 1-800-339-1193. I'd like to hear where you stand when it comes to ideology. Now, I have another video I like to show about individuals' ideologies, and this is based by a professor from NYU who is actually looking at this to kind of determine, based on certain items, for instance, if they look at a piece of art, does that basically consider and tell them if they're a conservative or a liberal or not? So how about we go into that and take a look at that short clip.
Could what kind of dog you like or what kind of painting you prefer also indicate who you're going to vote for in this election? One theory says yes, because your brain may actually be hardwired to make you a Democrat or a Republican. So my co-anchor Bill Weir hit the pavement to put it to the test.
Take a look at these two paintings. Which one do you prefer? Which one of these two offices most resembles your own? And if you were picking out a dog, would you prefer a breed that is gentle but independent and has a mind of its own, or one that is loyal, obedient, easy to train? Based on how you answer.
I like the top one better.
Top one?
Yes.
Okay. The lower one.
Mine's the top one.
The top one.
You're the top one.
Yeah.
Social psychologist Jonathan Haidt thinks he has a pretty good idea how you will vote.
Are you conservatives?
Yes.
Yes? Yes? Yes?
Yes? Sure. Yes. Say yes.
Because it turns out the conservatives like Jim prefer order in their paintings, pets, and workspaces, while left-leaning voters like his wife Shannon...
There's no denying that. That is him, that is me.
Not so much. Now, this sort of stereotyping can be offensive at first blush, but Professor Haidt uses them to illustrate where our political differences come from in the first place. He believes that when a baby is born, that little brain contains a few fundamental moral ingredients like empathy, fairness, respect for authority, and group loyalty. But as the child grows, both brain chemistry and life experience will make some of those ingredients a lot more important than the others.
It's not that they're born to be liberal or conservative, but as these kids grow up, they're going to be exposed to all kinds of ideas and social groups. And one maybe is a little more radical and obnoxious to authority. And that seems really cool to the first kid, but seems sort of disturbing to the second kid.
Which is why most people come into election years with minds made up, literally. And events like tonight rarely change them.
I think a lot of people, whether they're Fox News conservatives or MSNBC liberals, think if I just put my argument in the right way,
that's right,
I can win the other side over.
That's right.
That's impossible, though, right?
Well, and because I have put my argument in the right way and they still don't get it, that means they've got ulterior motives. That means they're not sincere.
Dependent. That's what Mitt Romney called 47% of Americans.
Mr. President, let us keep our jobs. We can't afford four more years.
Problem is, when a political system is broken, when massive fortunes are spent demonizing the other side, it's too easy to forget that a society needs both sloppy artists and uptight soldiers to survive.
We're all these moralistic creatures who are using our reasoning to support our side. We're not really open to the evidence. And the other side is not evil. The other side doesn't hate America and want to destroy it. Both sides are pursuing different moral visions, and we actually need elements of both to have a good society.
We complement each other.
Exactly. Liberals and conservatives really complement each other. If one side controls everything, the whole country is going to go to hell in very predictable ways.
Yes, believe it or not, liberal and conservative brains can actually complement each other. Just like Jim and Shannon.
Do you guys see yourselves as complementary? Do you work together well?
That's not what he asked.
Yeah, we do.
Do you have children?
No.
A furry dog that's very independent and doesn't mind. We'll just find some kids on the street, take them home, we'll do an experiment and get back.
Wow, you really are liberal.
Okay. So we just saw the segment based on a professor from NYU who suggests that depending on what you perceive, if it's a picture of art or the type of dog that you get, considers you to be either conservative or liberal. I'd be interested in knowing if you agree with that or not, if you found that to be substantive in how you perceive yourself to be a conservative or liberal in your political views. Now, just going over some other issues and policies out there. So we started the segment on why should we care about politics, correct? Why should we care and why, right? And then we talked about some different types of issues of why we should care about politics. Now, if we think about it today, when we look at these issues, there's a lot of issues out there. There's tons of issues, okay? So some issues and policies that I'd like to discuss. For instance, I'm just gonna go over these briefly. For the sake of the time for the segment that we have here. And also too, we could talk a little bit more about this when we meet again in the future. But for instance, the recent legislation on bath salts, that's something that also occurred as of recent. What happened in Washington, Colorado, as they allowed to legalize marijuana. Also the DREAM Act is another issue as well. If we think about here in California, there is a proposal saying that they want to implement a California speed train from San Francisco to LA to San Diego. Whether you agree that's a good thing to implement or you think that's billions of dollars wasted, I'll be interested in hearing your comment on that. So is a California speed train a good thing or would it be a bad thing? Because that's something that's on the table in negotiation at this moment. Who would like to come down to LA in a few hours on a train, or maybe that's not something that you may want to do. So that's another issue to think about because it's also an issue that's related to transportation. Also too, we are in talks here in the LA area for a football stadium. See how that turns out. Another issue that we have is abortion. Now I have some comments about a lot of the comments that I received were students and also viewers who consider themselves to be conservative and also known as pro-life. Now, there also is another side, and you will see this a lot in politics, is that there's always two sides to an issue. There's always people that are for issue, and there's always people that are against the issue. So you have the people that are support it, and you have the people who oppose it. Now, when it comes to abortion or any type of life issue, it does become a sensitive topic. So we have abortion is legal. In some states, there are restrictions. and we can go over that as we go on through the semester. But ever since Roe versus Wade, we do have abortion being legal. Okay. So another issue that we have too is the use of contraception has also become an issue. Also too, if you have a religious background, if you are religious, that can also maybe influence the way you perceive politics. Okay. Another issue is the Gideon versus Wainwright. Now that law, that case, excuse me, that lawsuit actually allowed for individuals to have the right to an attorney. So that's from the Gideon versus Wainwright. Another one too is Miranda versus Arizona, which enabled us to have our Miranda rights read to us as individuals are getting arrested. Also, Brown versus Board of Education is another issue that has been brought up in the past, but has significantly affected us because this allowed for individuals of different races to be in the same class. So no longer segregation. Also too, we have healthcare reform. Another issue, some people are for the Affordable Health Care Act, or also known as Obamacare, and some people are against it. So depending where you stand on this, be very interesting to hear what you got to say. Also too, other issues that we do have are political corruption, especially here at the local level, here in the LA area where we're at here. The city of Bell had also incurred corruption from their city council members. They're receiving a lot of a higher salary than normal, and they're basically stealing money from the people and putting it in their pockets. And they're actually going on trial right now. And the city of Bell, you may have not heard of it, or maybe you have, but it's actually a very small city out here close to the LA area. So that's happened. And also not just there, also political corruption has also occurred here for the LA County Assessor. Now the LA County Assessor, what they do is the Assessor's Department is basically determine how much property tax you have to pay on your house. Maybe you pay property taxes, or maybe your parents do, or somebody else in your family does. You got to pay it every, 6 months? But anyhow, the individual who spearheaded that department here in LA also was involved with political corruption, which is very unfortunate. And what happened is the person who headed this organization, from what I saw in the newspaper and also in the media, they were saying that he was lowering property tax rates for individuals who live in Brentwood, which is close to Beverly Hills, and lowering tax rates in order to get that income to support their campaigns. So as you know, that is illegal, and the person did get caught and is currently in jail. And so right now, I believe we have somebody who stepped in and is actually filling this person's position for now, but this just happened as of recently here in LA County. So political corruption does happen. Unfortunately, when people have too much power, sometimes some of these people don't know what to do with it, which leads to political corruption. So that's something else to think about too when it comes to that. Also, another issue is same-sex marriage. Now, some people are for same-sex marriage and some people are against it. And we'll talk more about same-sex marriage as we go through the semester. Another one we're going to talk about actually next week is the death penalty. How do you feel about the death penalty? Now, as of recently, there was a proposition for the death penalty to actually, instead of individuals being sent to death, they should get life in life without parole, life in prison. Now, unfortunately, that proposition did not pass, and I say that because I actually, I'm not for the death penalty. That's just my opinion, but maybe you are, or maybe you're against it. So I'd be interested in hearing what you have to say on the discussion board, which I have up posted on Blackboard. Okay, so are you for the death penalty or are you against the death penalty? Because that was a proposition that was on California's ballot as of recent, and that didn't go through. Which was very interesting because we actually had a proposition on the three strikes law amendment, and that passed. But when it came to death penalty, it didn't. So just something to think about. Okay, another one is gun control. And that's what we've been talking about today. We talked about gun control. Throughout the majority of this segment today is another issue that we have. Should we have more increased policies, and what type of policies should that entail, et cetera. So gun control is also another type of issue. And lastly, oil. Oil you could consider as another issue as well, because as you know, if you go to the gas station, our oil prices are going up. Okay, so everybody has to pitch in for gas. I'm just saying that. So, you know, however you view this, issues and policies, there's lots of them. There's a whole list of them. So depending on where you stand on this, you can look at one of these issues and really try to analyze and understand how can we go about solving this issue? Also, too, another issue, stem cell research. Stem cell research is another issue. Some people are against having, embryonic cells being tested for stem cell research or, et cetera. So that's another thing, too, that's also out there. And another issue, I know I said lastly a while ago, but I have another one, is also LWAP. And LWAP is life without parole. And this is for minors. Now, we're going to talk about LWAP when we meet again next week, because I do have a video that goes with that legislation. Now, for some of you who may not be aware of this law, it actually was just recently passed. So it was recently chaptered in as of this year, passed by our governor. And what LWAP is, well, what happened before is minors who committed an offense were sentenced to life in prison, basically. So they didn't have a second chance. Now, what basically this law, it's called the Fair Sentencing Act, which basically says that now that these individuals have done time in prison, let's say 10, 15 years, they can actually be considered to go to be actually released from prison based on various criteria. So based on if they had good behavior, if they have been contacting with their family, they're not contacting any negative people, et cetera. So LWAP is another issue that we'll talk about more next week, because I find it to be very interesting. I think you're also going to find it to be very interesting as well. And LWAP is actually an issue that I actually worked on when I was a lobbyist working in Sacramento in Northern California. And LWAP, we actually worked on it when I was there back in 2009, and it didn't pass. And in total, it took 6 years for this legislation to pass. So as of this year, this legislation is now current. So now individuals who have been sentenced to life without parole can now be reconsidered to be released. Okay? So I do have a last comment here that I'd like to share with you. And this is from Gabby, and Gabby does think that abortion should be legal, and a woman has a right to do what she believes is right, and especially about her body, because no one else can control that. Same-sex marriage should also be legalized as well. It is their decision. Okay, so I really appreciate your comments. We could talk about a lot of this stuff all day, because it's so large. And also, too, some of this stuff is very broad, and also, too, some of this is very concise. But I just want you to just start thinking about this, because there's so many issues out there. So when we meet again, we're going to talk about life without parole, and we're also going to be talking about the death penalty. So that will be for next Tuesday, same time, 3:00 to 4:30. And also, too, if you can send in your comments, or you could make a phone call, and we could do it live here on air. Or if you have any questions, you can email me at gsilvera@csudh.edu, and we will meet again. So thank you very much. You have a great day, and I'll see you next week. Thank you.